Good afternoon to all of you. How many of you are awake? All of you are awake? That's a very nice sign. I am very happy to see you all awake. With eyes open or the minds open? Or the mind shut and the eyes open? Many people keep their mind shut and the eyes open. So you have your minds open and the eyes also open, right? Just now, a legendary figure who was the principal of Sri Ram College of Commerce for 9 years and was the chairman, was the vice chancellor of a central university, was speaking to you a short while ago. And he asked you to ask, to create a curiosity in yourself, to go through your syllabus, to go through your textbooks, and then to ask questions. But you must always ask the right questions and not the wrong questions. Remember this. Because your faculty members are already repositories of knowledge. They possess far more superior knowledge than you. You are in your teens, you are undergraduates. So don't come out with foolish questions. Come out with intelligent questions, and that's possible only when you have gone through the entire textbook that you can frame to right or legitimate questions. Asking questions for the heck of it, please don't ask questions. Too many questions may lead to confusion and doubting thermoses if you have. First thing is that they should develop proper understanding of what you are asking. Are you asking something which is relevant or are you asking something which is irrelevant? Am I right? So don't ask too many questions. You ask a few questions, one or two questions, but those should be based on the basis of your study, careful study of the books that you are prescribed, or after carefully having gone through the lecture of a particular teacher or a professor here. So right questions, right? Now what does IT stand for? All of you are wrong. Tell me the right meaning of IT. What is IT? This question was answered by no other than the Triple IT Bangalore director, Professor Sadagopan. Professor Sadagopan. What does IT stand for? It stands for India Tomorrow. It doesn't stand for information technology. Maybe in your context, you are right, but then it is information technology which is going to take India into the 21st century. The very vision of India tomorrow, when Rajiv Gandhi, the youngest prime minister of this nation, he took over charge as prime minister, the first thing that he conceived for this nation was computerization. And then IT was born, perhaps a thought of India tomorrow, so that the worldwide you get connected with. It's good to stay connected with people, but it's good to stay connected with people who have some relevance in your life. There is an abuse of information technology rather than an appropriate use of it. So you want to make India tomorrow, if you want to realize that dream of India tomorrow, if you want to envision India of the 21st century, you need to use the technology for the right means. You should know what are you deploying. Technology should be deployed only when it is necessary for conducting your day-to-day life. Like online stores, there are plenty now. And there are online services also, which are being rendered by the civic agencies and by the government of NCT Delhi, by the central government, which is the single largest agency that hosts government websites, which is the single largest agency, government agency that hosts majority of the websites in this country. Huh? What? What does it stand for? What does it stand for? So, single largest agency that hosts all government sites. Now, what is important here is, when you say government means the Ministry of Defense, the Ministry of External Affairs. These are very sensitive ministries. So the information that has to flow has to be regulated and encrypted also. Right? It cannot be an average information. The defense headquarters information, the people who like to hack your DRDO, well, they like to know what new discoveries are being made in the field of defense research organization. DRDO is the most prestigious research organization. They like to know what advent, what new history is being created by India. You remember Abdul Kalam? Simple man, but created a high technology, based missiles. How many missiles are there in this country? And what's the role of computer sciences in creating missiles? Tell me that. Any one of you can answer that? How many types of missiles has India manufactured? That India man fired with a vision of creating intercontinental blasting missiles, surface-to-air missile, air-to-air missile, and the missiles that can be fired into the seas. There are five types of missiles. Can anyone name that? He will get 500 rupees. He or she will get 500 rupees price. Even teachers can participate in that. Tell me the number of, yes, you come here and tell me. Enlighten everybody here. Good, at least we have one boy, coming up to tell us how many types of missiles have India manufactured. And it has to be their names. I want to know that.
Agni-1.
Yeah, sure.
Agni-1 missile, which is capable of nuclear technology, first missile made by India, and Prithvi blasting missile made by India, Nag anti-tank missile made by India, and Tejas aircraft.
Name these missiles.
Agni, Prithvi, and Nag, and also the BrahMos and Barak 8 with the Indo-Israel relationship, Indo-Russian relationship. These are the missiles that are developed by India nowadays.
One shot. Yeah, one shot of it. Yes. Okay. You will get 400 rupees.
Sir, I can give one name.
Give 400 rupees to him. The price has to be instant, yes. So there's Prithvi, which is surface-to-air missile, right? There's Agni, which is nuclear-powered, and it's an intercontinental ballistic missile, which can go up to the range of 650 kilometers to 3,000 kilometers and even more. Then there's Akash. Then the BrahMos, as is rightly suggested, is sea, when you fire your missile within the sea and target the torpedoes and the ship of the enemy, right? So you created brilliant missiles, The Nag is created to neutralize any tank, howsoever powerful the tank may be. So technology has enabled our scientists. When you fire a rocket, a satellite, sometimes it is in the orbit of the Earth, sometimes it goes beyond the orbit of the Earth, and what is it called as? The orbit which is normally these satellites are spinning over. Yes, you had the correct answer. Tell me. Huh? I couldn't hear it. You stand up and reply. Huh? Ionosphere, So most of these satellites have been launched in the geostationary orbit. There are very many of them within the orbit of the Earth, But those who go beyond the orbit of the Earth, those are called as the satellites launched at 36,000 plus miles away from the Earth, and they are called the geostationary orbit. You have fixed the satellite in that particular thing, and anything, if you want reconnaissance satellites, their eyes focus on Nagpur so that they can see the whole of India. The central India, from there it can image, take images, it can measure anything, it can do mapping of the entire country, it can predict, forecast the tomorrow's weather. So accurate it has become now, the accuracy. It has all been enabled by, these are all programmed, remember this. Even when you go, when you cross the orbital, you know, the Earth's, you know, gravity, and you go beyond that, right? What happens? You lose weight. So all the astronauts, all these cosmonauts and astronauts, cosmonauts and astronauts, what is the difference between the two? Let me understand from you. Cosmonauts and astronauts, is there a difference? Teachers can also participate. Absolutely right. It means the same thing, very good. You will not get any money. You are teaching. You are already doing a very rewarding job. Teaching is a very rewarding job, right? So good, I am very happy to see that there are people who know the difference between astronauts and cosmonauts is nothing but the origin of the space sciences. And when a space shuttle goes, you know what all happens? It is all ground controlled. There is nothing that the astronauts or the cosmonauts are free to do. Can you imagine this? Everything is being controlled from the base. And many times it is in different countries, like in Bangalore, we can track the imagery, the itinerary of the satellite, where is it going. There are a few stations in Hassan and other places from where all these satellites being launched from foreign countries, they can be tracked down, and they depend on India for tracking down their satellites, whether they are in the right orbit or not. So this is all possible because of these computer sciences now. Enormous information, you know, being generated. The Hadron Collider comes very handy to me. Hadron Collider. How many of you know that there's a wonderful experiment going on in Geneva on the border of Switzerland? So large Hadron Collider. You know how much information is generating? 25 petabytes, and on how many computer grids is it being analyzed? 150 computer grids spread over 36 countries are trying to decipher that information. So who created these computer grids? And 36 countries and 10,000 scientists are busy doing all this. So computer sciences almost touches every facet of human life. But I want to tell you one thing from my life's experience. Never ever be imitators. Most of the time we are trying to imitate things. Copy it. Show it as our own. You will fail one day or the other. You will fail in life. Never ever imitate. But become intuitive minds, creative minds. The textbooks are not going to take you too far, let me tell you. If you really want to be genius, you have to go far beyond the textbooks. Theoretical knowledge is just not helpful. It can only be a stepping stone for you to see a further evolution of yourself and to come out with solutions. People will want solutions for their problems. You are going to the solution providers, not the problem creators. If you are not able to do that, if you only read the theory, and if you haven't really put into practice, and if you have been all the time imitating what others are doing, then perhaps your placement records may be very poor, in spite of all attempts by the IT department to see that the students are placed well. But don't expect any placements if you are not equipped yourself with the right kind of knowledge. So not much of imitation is required. You need to be very original in your ideas. You need to be intuitive in your ideas. You need to be come out with the creative, you know, ideas. Then only you are going to succeed in computer sciences. Computer science offers tremendous challenge. It's just not two words, the IT, and you say you're jubilant about it. Yes, I'll be doing my bachelor's in computer sciences and master's in computer sciences. Not enough. It's just not enough. These are the elementary courses. You need to graduate and further, you know, go up the ladder. And just not being armed with these degrees is not going to help you in life. You'll dump it somewhere in the alumina, but and maybe they are termite beaten and eaten one day, and you look at it, it's all going waste. You have to equip yourself with the superior knowledge in computer sciences. Let that whole information come from different sources. So there has to be no one source. There has to be no one teacher. You don't have to go the old beaten path, that this is the programming, this is what it is going to do, that's how you're going to do something in fuzzy logic, or you're going to look at something, artificial intelligence. I mean, there are different things that you will learn. You will learn oracles, Java, you will learn different languages. But how to put them into practice and how to come out with something new, which can create flutter, which can really shake the whole world and say, here I'm a different computer scientist. I know something different than what you have been doing routinely. Routinely I also do, I also know how to browse. And the World Wide, you know, Web helps me, enables me to browse any information. And Uncle Google is always with you. You can always type it out and find out what the solution is all about. From English to Hindi and Hindi to English, everything is available there. But then why should you become so very dependent on a machine? When you have creative minds, why don't you use the minds and you use the machines less? And you try to innovate. Try to give newer solutions. Who of you doesn't want respectability? Do you want to be respected? Do you want to earn respect? Do you want to beget respect for yourself? How do you beget respect? Shall you command people into respecting you? Shall you command people into respecting you? Or you want to beget respect by earning appreciation from within the society and say like Computer Society of India, for example. I just wrote two of these quotations, you know, to tell you from my cell phone, which I'm carrying, and that's very relevant. It came to me, I should do it for you because I had a session with you. So I'm using it for the right purpose, okay? I'm not abusing it. So you have to learn to use computer sciences for the right reason, for appropriate reasons, right? Prestige comes when you feel you have done something well. Prestige comes when you think that you have done something well. Honor comes when others feel you have done something else. When others think that you have done something well, you get recognition, you get honored. You get prestige only when you feel that you have done well. So there is a difference between this. The perceptions are two, these are two different perceptions. I may be satisfied with my work. Yes, I have done my job well. I have done my homework. I have done my task well in the college and the school or elsewhere. But is that enough? Wouldn't you like to earn honors? And honors will come when others applaud and appreciate your work. Then the honor will come to you. Who doesn't want honor? Who doesn't want prestige in life? Who doesn't want self-esteem? You will lose your self-esteem the moment they come to know that you are a stereotypist person. You can do nothing beyond this. They say, oh, you are this much, I also know. You need to know something different than what the rest of the people are, average people are doing, run-of-the-mill people are doing computer sciences. But you need to be, you need to distinguish yourself and be different. So the first quote that I wrote was, and these are my own creations, I don't depend on others. Prestige comes when you feel you have done well, something well. Honor comes when others feel that you have done something well. So perception is different, right? Listen to the wind, it talks. Have you ever listened to the winds? Listen to the winds. It talks. Listen to the silence, it speaks. Listen to the silence, it speaks. Listen to your heart and it knows whether you are a good being or a bad being. You'll get the answer. Your heart will tell you, no, I'm not going in the right direction. So there's a deep introspection. This power, as Professor Gupta put it, we have been endowed with knowledge. We've been armed with knowledge. You're armed with knowledge, but you're not using it for the right cause, for the right purpose. So then what will happen? So you have to be very, very conscious of the fact that the information technology is very handy, but all these social networking sites which you get glued to, and the tick, 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 tick doing on your smartphones, and the games and all these things, Facebook and LinkedIn and whatnot, and connects you with the whole world. But remember one thing, these can be a massive hazard for your progress in your career. It can be a major impediment in your career. Don't simply think that's easier doing it at the touch of the finger. I can access this information. But the information can be both constructive as well as negative. It can destroy you as well. The information itself has the power to destroy. Have you heard of the Goebbels theory? Goebbels theory, he was a German, you know, warrior. He just gave rumors, you know, which will go afloat, which will demoralize the other country's enemy, which was the Britain at that time. And many times, they become so intuitive. I'll narrate you one of the incidents which happened during the World War II. German came out with a biological warfare. You know, what is biological warfare? When toxic gases, you know, they are released into the atmosphere and the soldiers breathe and get paralyzed. You know what the British scientists did? They discovered which can fight the metallic poisoning which was taking place with that gases. Those were metallic gases. And they came out with an injection which is still called as BAL. That is a British anti-leucocyte. The whole adverse effects of the gases can be neutralized with one injection. So this is the warfare. And remember, this tug of war goes on between in each one of your mind. It goes on. Most of the time you are tempted to browse, you know, send messages, write something, do some Facebook comments. Anything is now at the tip of the, you know, at the touch of the finger. But you need to contemplate and think whether it's going to help in your growth or it's going to stunt your growth. Many things will take away all your precious time. And IT is one of those hazardous, I mean, it's one of those professional hazards. I'll call it professional hazard. Why? Because computer scientists know not that their most precious time is being utilized by all these social networking sites. You may do good networking. But if you are doing good networking, do it with NASA. Do it with DRDO. Do it with some of the brilliant scientists in computer sciences. Be in touch with them. Have an information, because information is power. If you want to empower yourself, Try to have the information from all quarters and enrich yourself. But you have to filter that on the screen of truth, whether it's a falsehood being spread on a particular website that you will lose your weight in 20 kgs of weight in 10 days, which is impractical, which you will play with your metabolic system. So you need to filter the information which you are receiving through different quarters on the filter of truth, whether it's the right thing to accept in life or whether it's the right, it's the time to reject it. So you have to develop a thought process. And it has to be so well, you know, you have to learn to introspect at the end of the day. Am I an achiever or am I a loser? Can you devise this kind of a mechanism? This is already there within. You don't need to look at it. You don't need to outsource it. There are very many things that you outsource. But here there's something which is not, which cannot be outsourced, which is absolutely personal, where you can introspect at the end of the day, am I an achiever or am I a loser? You can do a stock taking every day in the evening and you can see whether you are progressing or it's a retrograde progress. You're going down or going up. Who doesn't want to go up in one's career? Everyone has the wishbone. Everyone has the wishbone, but you don't have the backbone to support your dream, your contentions. You have an imagination, you think very high. You rate yourself very high. You are not objectively assessing yourself at the end of the day whether all this knowledge that I have amassed is going to help me in my progress or is it going to retard my progress. If you can develop this kind of a mechanism in yourself that you can introspect and find out with yourself, do your own self stock taking at the end of the day and know how much progress have I made or am I standstill? Is it going to help me in my career advancement, in bringing more prestige, more honor to me, or is that going to bring dishonor to me? So never ever indulge in things which take away your precious time and yet you think that at the end of it you will pass your graduation or post-graduation courses and you will say, I am proud to have done my master's degree now, I am fully equipped to get an employment. No, sir, you will not get the employment if you don't have the requisite skills. So it has to be a skill-based knowledge. It is an applied science. It is an applied science. If you don't apply sciences, there is an applied medicine. We read textbook of medicine by Harrison, which had about 250 plus contributors, which contributed one of the particular systems of the body. There are huge number of, there is a huge reservoir of knowledge, but the knowledge has to be accessed with discretion. You have to exercise discretion at every level. You have to create filters. And if you are accessing information which weakens your resolve, you must have resolved something in life. I want to be doing this and I want to be doing that. Anything which weakens your resolve, must you stop there. And anything that gives strength to your resolve, because you need to, at the end of your graduation, at the end of your post-graduation, you need to achieve something. You need to be an achiever and not a loser. All those who keep their eyes open and the mind shut will never progress. The mind, the parachute, they work only when they're kept open. They function the best. Keep your minds open, wide open. It has to be a skill-based and employment-oriented education. It cannot be an education just a certificate in your hand and you say that I am now equipped to get employment, I am eligible, I qualify. No, you will not qualify. When the placement agencies come, they have a very, very strict filtration system. They'll filter you out. They'll say, no, thank you. We don't require you. You'll be a liability to the organization. You have to start thinking in this context that times come when you want to be placed and your parents also want you to be placed after you have got a postgraduate degree. But then are you eligible to be employed? Do you have the requisite skills to benefit that organization or are you going to be a liability to it? You have to start thinking now. If you don't start thinking now that you need to be skill-based, it is an application-based knowledge that you have to amass. You don't have to be theoretical simply. The applicability and the employability, both will depend on the skills that you acquire. The greater the skills, the more values you carry. The greater the package you carry, the greater the respect you command. And one day your parents also will say, yes, we put them in the right institution, which has helped them in their growth, which has not stunted their growth. But you are the people, you are the stakeholders, you are the people who have to participate in this mission actively and to see that whatever you have dreamt or taken, you know, you have seen some dreams, you have been dreaming and dreaming and dreaming, you have resolved to accomplish something that can only happen when you keep your minds and eyes open and the ears also open. You have some quizzes, you have some kind of competitions through which, I mean, skill-based learning can be encouraged. The Government of India is doing all this skill-based learning. Startups, there's so many initiatives for the coming up, the people who are always thinking, going ahead of it. The evolution is a process that's a continuous process. You can't stagnate, you can't afford to remain, you know, what you are. You don't need to be static, but you need to be continuously progressing forward from truth to higher truth, from little learning to a higher learning. And one day you'll find that you are the most sought after professionals. The placement agency will come here and say, here is an institution which gives us the requisite talent, which gives us the best of people who know the computer sciences so very well that they will be of much utility to us. Your utility has to be viewed now for the engaging agency, for the employers. Employers will not take a liability home. Then, no, your face is very good, you are very well dressed, you are very nice to communicate with, your communication skills are not going to help. Whatever superior knowledge comes to you from different quarters, from different sources, you need to access the information and make it in an applied form. Learn it in an applied form. Only the fittest will survive, and the not so fit will automatically get eliminated in the process of placements. So I just want to caution you that, ladies and gentlemen, you need to keep your minds open and your eyes also open. And you should also be very attentive in the classes, because all these faculty members, they are all repositories of knowledge. They are far superior knowledge. The only thing is, if you deserve, you will get it. And all those who don't deserve, they want to bunk classes, they want to have fun at the cost of their studies, then remember this, you will come to your grief. And no placement agency is going to give you a good placement. So you have to do double the hard work. You have to be in the class, and you have to be there at home studying computer sciences, any branch you pick up, any book you pick up, but must you be obsessed with computer sciences day in and day out? You should access maximum information. MS it, come and ask the relevant questions, not the irrelevant ones. While framing the questions, you have to be very careful. Professor Gupta, with all his experience and his mother's, you know, very intimate talk with him, and telling him that I'll judge you by what quality of questions you are asking in the class. Because you can only frame quality questions when you have read the textbook. When you read a certain book, then only you can frame the right questions. Otherwise, you'll be asking the wrong questions, wasting the teacher's time and your own time also. Don't do that. Never ever embarrass the teachers. You must have immense faith in your teachers and their capabilities. They have cleared so many hurdles to be teachers. Always respect the teachers. I'll only expect you, because when we heard of that we got the maximum placements in Wipro, it was a proud moment for me. I happened to go to Bangalore, and herds of our students, they came, they were in different IT industry. They came and they entertained us so well, that I was completely moved. I mean, what a love, what a affection they were showering on us. Sir, you enabled us to become what we are today. The IT industry respects us for the knowledge that we possess, and it is a superior knowledge than the rest. Today, it is they who go in interviews and placement other things. So I thank the entire faculty of the Information Technology Department and the Dean, who very painstakingly makes all efforts in seeing that the last student here gets placed. But simply placement is not just our job. You have to add value to your placement. You have to be an asset to the organization that you are going, so that when we get the feedback, we get a positive feedback about you, that you sent us some students, some professionals, because then you will become professionals. So you should be professionals who should be respected by your organization. And when you start getting respect, the honor will come to you from the society. Your parents will recognize you. They'll appreciate you. And I think that's the biggest reward that you can get as daughters and sons of this motherland, that you are doing something which is going to help India grow and grow and grow and grow into a mighty power. Thank you very much.